I'm Bo Moore with IGN, and this is the Steam Deck, Valve's brand new handheld gaming PC. I'm here at Valve, where I've spent the last few days going hands-on with the Steam Deck, as well as chatting with the people who made it. We've got a lot to cover, so let's dive right in.
When I first saw the Steam Deck, I was a bit thrown off by its control layout. The thumbsticks are in line with the D-pad and face buttons, which looks a bit odd when you're used to the more offset angle found on most controllers. However, as soon as I held it myself, the layout felt completely natural. The full-size thumbsticks felt precise, and while the D-pad wasn't quite as clicky as I'd like, it was fully serviceable for rounding out some quarter circles in Guilty Gear Strive. Similarly, the face buttons and bumpers all felt solid and served me well through a few runs of Hades. The triggers did feel a little bit squishy for my taste, but it's worth noting that I was using a non-final hardware unit, so it's possible that things might improve there as Valve tweaks the deck before launch. On the backside are four rear buttons, a welcome feature for anyone who's grown accustomed to using pro-style controllers like the Xbox Elite. These, like the rest of the buttons and other inputs, can be fully customized to whatever you like thanks to Steam Input, Valve's commitment to making useful custom key bindings available for almost any controller layout. Underneath the thumbsticks are one of the deck's standout features, two precision trackpads, which give you access to mouse controls for games that don't play well with a controller.
The trackpads here are an evolution of the same technology that we've been working on since the Steam controller days and experimenting with internally. You also have seen some of our trackpad work as part of the Index controller, for example. They can be used for many different things. We have a keyboard that lets you do dual thumb typing. In-game, you can map them to areas of the screen for a mouse cursor to jump there and be kind of a one-to-one region type input. You can create on-screen menus that pop up on top of the game and have many customizable like macro buttons or keyboard keys. And you can just use it for mouse input, where it's really powerful and reliable for the people that are comfortable with that sort of input.
Both the thumbsticks and the trackpads are also capacitive, which means they can tell when your finger is on them. Combined with the internal gyro sensor, it gives you a weirdly precise level of control that, after a brief adjustment period, is honestly not far off from using a regular mouse. Yes, even in first-person shooters like Doom Eternal. Finally, the 7-inch screen is touch-enabled as well, giving you yet another option for controlling your games. The Steam Deck will draw immediate comparisons to the Nintendo Switch, but while it might look like a handheld console, Valve's device has much more in common with a desktop gaming PC. The Steam Deck runs a custom version of Steam OS that gives you a console-like experience on the surface, but under the hood is a full-blown PC.
It's a PC. We don't think people should be locked into a certain direction or a certain set of software that they can install. If you buy a Steam Deck, it's a PC. You can install whatever you want on it. You can attach any peripherals you want to it. Maybe a better way to think about it is that it's a small PC with a controller attached as opposed to a gaming console.
I think it differs from these kind of platforms mainly because you can just customize the experience and use all the options at your disposal that are typically associated with PC gaming. We think that while that there will be a pretty approachable entry point where you can see the games that work really well by default and get a pretty seamless gaming experience. If you want to go one step further and use all of these options, you can. Customize your controls, your level of performance, battery life, use Steam Workshop or even mods that are outside of the Steam Workshop. All these options that are dear to PC gamers are fully supported by the deck.
This means you can do pretty much anything on it that you can do at your desk. Plug in a mouse and keyboard? Yep. Tab out of your games to a browser or video? Sure. Load up third-party programs or even other game stores? No problem. You could even wipe SteamOS entirely and install a fresh version of Windows if you want. But I will say the default SteamOS is smooth and efficient at getting you into your games, so I would imagine most people won't want or need to go that far. The point is, you can if you want to. Importantly, this also means that all of Steam's features, like cloud saves, are fully functional here. You can start playing a game on your desktop PC, save and quit, then load up and continue playing portably on your Steam Deck, with all of your progress, key bindings, and mods fully intact. You can also suspend games indefinitely on the deck itself, similar to how the Switch works. though you can't have multiple games suspended at once, like with Quick Resume on the Xbox Series X. Valve also told me that they're looking into ways to cloud sync suspended games between desktop and deck, meaning you could potentially hop between platforms without needing to save and quit. But that functionality wasn't in place yet during my time with the device. While the Steam Deck is obviously designed for portable gaming, it's also fully functional as a desktop PC. Using a USB-C dock, you can connect it to a monitor, mouse and keyboard, Ethernet, and whatever other peripherals you want. Valve is developing an official docking station, which will be sold separately, but a standard USB-C dock will work just as well. In desktop mode, Steam Deck honestly just feels like a PC. The OS is Linux-based, but it feels largely familiar to Windows and is capable of running both Windows and Linux games. I played a bit of Factorio and Death Stranding with mouse and keyboard on a 32-inch monitor, and if it weren't for the deck sitting docked next to me on the desk, I would have honestly just forgotten that it wasn't running off of a traditional desktop PC. Of course, a PC gaming device isn't worth much if it can't play games well. But worry not, in the power department, the Steam Deck is no slouch.
We've been partnering pretty closely with AMD on bringing up a next generation APU and developing the main board and the software solution around it. It has like four cores of Zen 2 architecture CPUs with SMT enabled, so up to 8 threads. And the GPU is based on the very latest AMD RDNA 2 architecture, which supports all the latest features like ray tracing and variable ray shading. The total APU combined power is about 2 teraflops, which should let people play the games that they have in their library without issues at 720 and provides lots of horsepower to that effect.
2 teraflops puts the Steam Deck in the ballpark of the Xbox One and PS4. In practice, it's actually more impressive than that. Since it targets a 720p resolution, which is more than enough for the 7-inch screen, the Steam Deck is able to play current-gen PC games at medium to high settings at smooth frame rates. While I wasn't able to run benchmark tests during my hands-on time, I played Death Stranding, Doom Eternal, Control, and several others, all of which looked great and played smoothly. The Deck comes in 3 different models, but power-wise, they all have the same internals. The only difference is in storage space. The base model has 64 gigs of storage for $399. Moving up to the 256 gig model costs $529, while the top end will cost $649 for 512 gigabytes. All 3 storage devices are SSDs, however, the 256 and 512 gig models use an NVMe drive for even faster load times. And while the internal storage itself can't be upgraded, there's an SD card slot to expand your storage even further, which games can be installed onto and played directly off of.
The Steam Deck will be available this holiday season with reservations starting soon. We've got a lot more coverage planned all month long, so for all that and more, keep it right here at IGN.